Hello, and welcome to your library at home. My name's Jade, and I am part of the library's public programming team. I would like to begin by acknowledging that we meet today on country. I live and work on Gadigal land and take this opportunity to pay my respects to elders past, present, and especially emerging. I would also like to extend that respect to any Aboriginal Australians who are joining us today. Welcome to another instalment of our Curator's Choice, where we'll be hearing from Maggie Patton. Maggie is responsible for leading the curatorial team in the research and discovery branch at the library. She provides expert advice on activities that develop, interpret, and promote discovery and engagement within the State Library's collections, and she has a particular interest in maps and rare books. In this presentation, Maggie will discuss infrastructure reports to rival today's nation-building projects. If you have any questions for Maggie, you can type them in the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom screen, and I'll be back again at the end of the talk. But for now, please welcome Maggie.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Jade, and thank you for coming this afternoon. I'm seeing this presentation as a bit of an introduction to Thomas Livingstone Mitchell and his activity in the colony, as he could be the subject of a series of presentations, a larger-than-life man interested in fossils, poetry, mechanical arts. He invented a propeller based around the boomerang. He surveyed the gold fields near Bathurst and brought back his own case of gold. And of course, he's very well known for the several expeditions that he led into the interior of the colony between 1831 and 1847, following the path of the Darling, the Murray, and even travelling down to Port Phillip. Larger than life, if you've been just watching the debate, perhaps in the 21st century, Thomas Livingstone Mitchell might have been a very similar sort of controversial figure. Mitchell was born on the 15th of June 1792 in Scotland. He arrived in the colony in 1827, following his appointment as assistant surveyor. And on the death of John Oxley, he became the Surveyor General of New South Wales from 1828 until his death in 1855. The library holds many of his maps, notebooks, and detailed sketches and watercolours, and a lot of that material has been digitised. So on the screen here, we have a painting of Mitchell in the uniform of the 1st Rifle Brigade of the 95th Regiment, complete with his whistle used to direct the movement of troops, and a silhouette also in the 1830s. But as I said, I'm going to concentrate today on just the surveys that he did, particularly on the development of the colony. However, prior to his work in New South Wales, he served as a second lieutenant in the regiment in the Peninsular War with the battles of Ciudad, Rodrigo, Badajoz, and Salamanca. And he provided topographical intelligence during the war and after the war. He was selected to provide a cartographic record of the battles after the war as well. So he clearly was recognised for his drafting skills as early as that first period in the army. The State Library actually owns what appears to be Mitchell's own copies of his drafts and the trial proofs of the lithographs for this account of the Peninsular War, and which was finished at the end of 1840 and published by James Wilde. So on the screen here, we have actually the passport, which was given to Mitchell by the Duke of Wellington to travel to the peninsula. And this is just a couple of examples of the beautiful work that he did in drafting. So if you can see the incredible detail here, and this is before he comes to the colony. So you can see what a skilled draftsman and surveyor he was at that point. He was also colourful, as we said, and he was known to be in the last official duel in New South Wales between himself and Stuart Alexander Donaldson I think it's in September 1851. Donaldson was a well-known settler of the New England region, was later elected to the Legislative Council and became Premier of New South Wales in 1856. Apparently there was a very hostile meeting during the elections, and according to the Sydney Morning Herald, which you can see the clip there, in his speech, Donaldson suggested that the Surveyor General's department cost £40,000 per annum, and Sir Thomas Mitchell contradicted Mr. Donaldson's statement and suggested that the public would stamp its own reprobation upon a monstrous charge so falsely or so carelessly made to his prejudice. Them are fighting words, and apparently they had a duel. The men fired three shots, and Mitchell's last shot reportedly blew off Donaldson's hat. So we have very curious things in the collection. So so Mitchell also played a role in politics, and in April 1844, he was elected to the Legislative Council in Port Phillip. As a representative of Port Phillip, he had promised to support the separation of that district from New South Wales. And his boss, Governor Sir George Gipps, was not happy with the idea that the member for Port Phillip might act as he pleases, but the Surveyor General of New South Wales must obey and support the government. So Mitchell clearly had a problem separating his two roles, his individual in politics and his role with the government. And look up on the screen here, I have what I think is a fantastic example of a voting card from 1844. So this is how you would have voted in an election back in the early days of the colony. And you can see that the library was very keen to stamp our claim to this particular small piece of ephemera. And it looks, look, we were, it's donated to the library in 1969. So Mitch was also one of the colony's most talented natural history illustrators. And so here we have drawings, just examples from his expedition into the interior in 1831 to 35. A beautiful illustration here, fruit from the bank of large lagoon, tall slender tree like cedar or mountain ash, which was captured in December 1831. And here a ship is a fish from. But let's get to his survey work. So when he was appointed as assistant surveyor in 1827, and then in 1828, when Oxley died, he became the Surveyor General. In 1829, he was also responsible for survey of roads and bridges. So his remit expands. It appears that the survey office at the time was not in a good position. It was understaffed. It was underfunded. And so all of this sort of added to the difficult situation that he walked into when he became the Surveyor General. And they were responsible not just for the major survey of the colony, but also the surveys for all of the land grants and the smaller cadastral work that had to be done by the survey office. This is the engraved map of 19 counties, which was one of the first tasks accomplished for the general survey. And you can see the 19 counties there. Each county was divided into hundreds, and then each hundred was divided into parishes. And each parish was around an area of 25 square miles, and Mitchell was given specific instructions on how he was to set up this survey and show the 19 counties, and it really replicated the way that things were done back in the United Kingdom. This beautiful hand-coloured version is part of the Mitchell collection, and of course this survey was supposedly at the time so accurate that Mitchell was granted his knighthood, so he then became Sir Thomas Mitchell. So this is the report itself that we're looking at. And so Sir William Dix Denison became Governor General of Australia. And only 3 weeks after he came into office in 1855, he questioned Mitchell about his survey techniques and the conduct of the survey department. And in July 1855, a formal inquiry was set up with the proceedings held at the Sydney Mechanics School of Arts in Pitt Street. This report was prepared for the Commission of Inquiry, which was to look at the extent and character of the surveys with reference to their accuracy and ability to arrange expeditiously and favourably for present and future occupation of public lands and the distribution of staff members with emphasis on the amount of work carried out relative to its cost. So a very typical brief for a government report yesterday and today. So while this was part of a formal inquiry, the compilation that Thomas Mitchell put together has a fantastic record of the work carried out in the colony. So this is an image of the contents. You can see some beautiful copper plate writing there. This would have been done for Mitchell if you actually have a look at any of his original manuscripts. His handwriting certainly wasn't as neat as this, but this is absolutely perfect to read. And so this is the contents list of the report, and it shows the work that was carried out from 1827 to 1855. And as you can see here, it includes 47 illustrations and plans. So the moment that Mitchell came into office, he began the work of surveying and developing the colony. In 1830, he planned a new network of roads from Berrimah towards Goulburn. He looked at a new western descent at Mount Victoria to Bathurst. They developed routes for the Great South Road towards Camden to Illawarra and the Great Northern Road towards Newcastle. Great deal of work was also done in the city around Watson's Bay, Circular Quay, improved access to Botany Bay. So a lot of detailed work in this report. Now, he also includes in this report details on how they did the survey for the main part of the colony. And I tell you, I am not attempting to explain how this was done, but you can see there's principal points and there's all sorts of angles, and we need a surveyor to explain how that works. But if you ever want to, come in and have a look at this report. So this is another example of one of the beautiful illustrations in the report. And this is showing the pass at Victoria. And you can see that, yes, once again, Mitchell is showing off his drawing skills in this report. This here shows a sketch of the different lines of road descending down to the Blue Mountains towards Bathurst. So if we actually have a look at this, you'll see here Blue Mountains from Sydney. And then if you have a look up here, you'll see the beautiful hashiel work. So before we actually started to use, I've forgotten the word, you know, now we would have, oh, the name's escaping me, it'll come to me in a minute. But you can see the closeness of these strokes indicates the steepness of the hills, and this is what they used to use at this period. But you can see here, there's the old road. So here we have the present road. Can you see my cursor working there? Present road. And then you can see the intended road that Mitchell is going to plot. So this is very detailed work, quite beautiful. And you can see here, we've got the cross section showing the descent down towards Bathurst. A lot of these roads that you can see still exist today in their various forms. This one here shows you an area north of Sydney. So you can see here we have Parramatta, oh, I've gone too far. You can see here we have Parramatta Road. And then we can see here, so Iron Cove Creek, which no longer exists. But you can see the road that they're plotting up towards the north here. So Long Bottom here, this is where the government farm existed and timber yard, and it was an area to rest convict work parties travelling between Parramatta and Sydney. You can see that's largely the area where we would see Concord. People living on the Parramatta River were quite isolated, and they requested a punt to enable them to travel across the river and then up the Northern Road. And this punt here was used until the Gladesville Bridge was built many years later. This plan here shows the proposed line of road from Sydney Tollgate to Parramatta and Liverpool, surveyed by Robert Huddle. Now, Robert Huddle was one of the assistant surveyors, but he, of course, was very well known for the work that he did around the Port Phillip district. And so he was actually the one who developed the Huddle grid in Melbourne. I've turned this plan on its side so that you can see. Over here we have, here we have Sydney from Liverpool. If we come over here, you can see where we've got, there's a toll gate over here. Hold on, let me go back. You can see where the toll gate is here, Sydney toll gate. And then you can see the line of the road, which Mitchell and his office is proposing here. This one here is a plan of roads northwards from Sydney from a survey made in 1829. And this is what, thank goodness I've written down it in my notes. What we're talking about is contour lines. So we would now use contour lines, but in those days they would use hachure strokes to show the steepness. So if we have a look at this one in a little bit more detail. So if you come over here, you can see here's Broken Bay, here's the Hawkesbury River, and you can see Wiseman's Ferry here. And you can just see the line of road that they're proposing, the Great Northern Road, which then will take us up to the Myer Ranges, up to Newcastle. So all of this work was done in this very early period with Mitchell, and this survey was done in 1829. This one here is the passage of the River Hawkesbury at Wiseman's Ferry, so a little bit more detailed. And you can actually see here we have the punt across the Wiseman's Ferry, which of course is still there today. And then you can, if you look a little bit closer, you can see the road leading up to the Great North Road. See how these hachure lines show how steep this area here is around Wiseman's Ferry, and then on the other side here. Beautiful work. This one here is a different one. It's the other end of this, of Sydney. It's looking at the Razorback obstruction. So of course, south of the city as part of the Great Dividing Range, you have the Razorback Mountains here. And so in this particular plan, you can see that they are proposing, if we go into the next slide, you'll see if you look at this. So it tells you the current roads, the proportion which is trying to be done, the proposed line of road, and then Mr. Schoen's central line of railway. So Mr. Schoen was one of the assistant surveyors in the survey office, and so he's down here planning for the new railway structures. But if you actually have a look at this, you can see the old road, and then you can see the new road, which Mitchell is proposing, which is much further away from this very hilly, difficult area of Razorback. Beautiful detailed drawings. This one here is a plan of Cumberland showing the new line of road. So of course, Cumberland, the county of Cumberland, stretched from Broken Bay, the Hawkesbury River, down to Wollongong. It was named after the Governor Philip named it, after the Duke of Cumberland. So the county of Cumberland was a term that was used very, very early from 1788. But here you can see in this view of the county of Cumberland, if we travel up here, you can see at the top here we have Parramatta up here. You can see the track out to Liverpool. You can then see a very detailed sketch coming from Parramatta into the city here at Darling Harbour, places that we would be familiar with, Ashfield, the Iron Cove Creek again. So you can see these are very detailed surveys, are very important for the development of the city. You can see this is probably, you know, here's Ashfield Station now. If we were coming here, we'd be heading down here, the Hume Highway, down towards Liverpool. And here we'd be travelling across Parramatta and then up to the mountains. This is another one showing the roads down to the Illawarra. Hold on, let's go back a slide here. Here we have the Georges River, and you can see these very detailed lines of road leading down to the Illawarra, to Colcliffe, and down to the south coast here. Now Wollongong, of course, this is the plan of Wollongong in 1854. Wollongong became a town in 1843, a municipality in 1859, and a city much later on. But you can see how Mitchell's work and the survey office wasn't just about roads, but also about cities and towns as well. So you can see what we would see here is that traditional grid of roads that were in Wollongong that were sketched here. But you can see here in 1888, that grid still exists in later surveys and plans. Beautiful, beautiful lines here showing the outcropping there at Wollongong. So of course, Wollongong, the name originates from an Aboriginal word. And although you can't see it on many of these plans and charts from the report, Mitchell himself had a lot to do with Aboriginals in his various expeditions. He would often use Aboriginal guides. He would often adopt Aboriginal names for towns and places on his maps. So quite a controversial relationship, but he certainly did acknowledge the knowledge and the ownership of the Aborigines in various areas that he actually surveyed. This one here is another one of Illawarra, and you can see as we move down, the line of road down here, across down here, once again, down the Illawarra line. This is a sketch from just showing you a little bit about some of the city work they did. Of course, Thomas Mitchell owned Craig End, a very large villa just east of the city. And you can see here in 1832, he's proposing to the colonial secretary how the roads could be changed to make better access out to the coast. Of course, following the inquiry, there was a report. So this report went to the inquiry and there was a number of comments that came out from the Board of Inquiry. And I've got a few comments here. Despite criticism of the nature of the survey, the commissioners stated that we do not wish in any way to detract from its intrinsic encounters, merits, or underrate the energy and determination with which dangers were encountered, difficulties surmounted, and hardships endured in the source of the surveys. While acknowledging the energy which was characterised in the personal efforts of the Surveyor General Mitchell in carrying out his general surveys, they did acknowledge the benefits conferred upon the country by his expeditions, but they did feel compelled to remark that the efficiency of the department had suffered from his long absences from the actual supervision of his department, and to refer to the want of the mutual good feeling and cordial cooperation between the Surveyor General and his officers. So clearly things weren't good back at the Surveyor's office. He wasn't often there. He often had other things that he was more interested in. And so perhaps the government thought that the report was certainly very detailed in what Mitchell and his surveys office had achieved, but not necessarily what they were looking for. So Mitchell did not hear the final verdict on the inquiry, despite putting in that report. He contracted a chill while surveying the line of road between Nellerton and Braidwood. He developed pneumonia and he died in his house in Sydney in 1855. He was survived by his widow and 12 children, although 5 of them predeceased him. Many of them actually were employed by him and his department, which is another issue that created friction with the government. So I'm just going to finish with one of my favourite charts produced during Mitchell's time. And this is the 1855 survey of Port Jackson. And it's a beautiful thing to behold. So Mitchell's report details a lot of the work they did. And he was obviously a cantankerous man, produced some beautiful work. So thank you very much for listening today. I hope that you found some of those maps interesting and that they were familiar to you in some ways as we drive around the city and the outside Sydney. Thank you. Questions? G'day, hello.
Hello, thank you, Maggie. The images and illustrations you shared today are absolutely incredible. We've had quite a good response to your talk, but before I get into that, just a little reminder to everyone that you can type in any comments or questions into the Q&A function at the bottom of your Zoom screen.
And Jude, can I just say, if you've got a pen and pencil, that report is fully digitized. Well, the illustrations from that report is fully digitized and online. So if people have got a quick pencil there, they can write the URL if they find difficulty finding it in the catalogue.
Great. That was actually one of the questions. Can we see these online and are they available digitally? So yes, they are.
Yes, they are. Not the entire report. After doing this talk, when you do a talk, you always find something else you have to do. So I need to get the entire beautiful copperplate report digitised, but the illustrations and plans are digitised.
Wonderful. Now, someone has asked, are these made with Indian ink and watercolour? What is the quality of the paper?
Some of them are on good quality paper. Clearly, it's been put together quite quickly for the inquiry. So some of the paper is quite fine and fragile. Most of them are pencil and pencil ink, a mixture of different techniques. Yeah. But I think that's one of the reasons why very early on the illustrations and plans were digitised, because the paper is quite fragile.
Yeah, that's great. Brittany has asked, did Mitchell's survey work determine the directions of city town growth, much like modern city planners?
Yes. So that's what they were doing. They were surveying out into the country areas, deciding where the roads would go and then where the major villages and cities and towns would be. So yes, that was one of their major activities. So when he did the map of the 19 counties, that was the settled areas. And then, of course, the squatters and new immigrants coming in settled outside those 19 counties. And the survey office had responsibility for surveying and documenting and measuring all of those areas outside the city.
That's great. Naya has commented, I'm trying to find the Sydney Arms in 1833 at the corner of York and King Street. Interesting.
Well, look, just try the catalogue. It's an amazing thing. You could probably just put a few keywords in and you might find it. But you can also ask a librarian. It's always on our website.
Oh, yeah. Definitely, if you can, ask a librarian. Someone has asked, do we know of any errors in the maps?
There clearly were some errors, because that's one of the things that the report said after the inquiry, that not all of the measurements were reliable. And later surveyors made comments about the accuracy of some of the surveys. So I suppose, look, it was a large office. There would have been over 20 different surveyors, assistant surveyors that he was supervising. They would have had different skills around them. And let's remember what the report said. It was difficult ground, rocky, quite difficult to survey. So it's not surprising that they're, you know, a survey always improves somebody else's survey.
Do any of the survey maps show the same location over time?
Yes, they do. I think if you have a look at all of them, you'll see that you can see Sydney changing in a couple of plans. Like there'll be a couple of plans from the late 20s, and then you'll see them again a little bit later, and they will have developed. Yes. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of changes to Sydney between 1827 and 1855.
That's great. And I believe this is the last question, which is a little bit more personal for you. Maggie, what has drawn you to research and specialise in maps?
Well, I suppose sometimes things just fall. It wasn't my aim. I think sometimes you fall into a position and you discover how amazing it was. So I applied for the position of head of maps many years ago. I didn't know much about maps. I probably used them a little bit in research. But I thought it was an opportunity to learn more about the collections and sort of expand my knowledge. And it really has, because I think over time you become really interested in the way maps are a beautiful object. They show amazing techniques. They show a side. They show where you are in the world. They show you where you're going. They show you how history has changed the way we look at the world. Anyway, they're full of the multi-dimensional. And so I fell into it and now it's fantastic. And I hope everyone appreciates maps. And next year we're going to do a big exhibition. And so I hope you all come along.
Thanks again, Maggie, for your interesting talk. And we look forward to more upcoming Curator's Choice. For other events, everyone, you can head over to the library website and visit our What's On page. But thank you for joining us today and hope you all have a good weekend. Until next time.
Bye. Good afternoon.